we are celebrating Grandma B's birthday. She's 86 years young today, and this is a special family occasion. I want to start by asking Grandma B what she thinks of the food at Au Luck on your birthday. Grandma B, what do you think of the food of Au Luck on your birthday?
Excellent. Delicioso. Muy bueno.
Vietnamese, whole plant-based fresh food.
Yes, and the soy, the way they spice the soy product to make it taste like a shrimp, and you can't tell the difference. If I were to give you a real shrimp and a soy prepared shrimp here, you would not know the difference. And then there's a chicken. They do all kinds of different animal flavors using soy products.
You and I were raised in a generation that revered the four food groups and meat and dairy.
Well, yes, I fed you every I didn't think of oatmeal for breakfast would be sufficient for my children, so you were raised on eggs and bacon every morning to go to school. And I created a 200-pound kid that had to wear husky jeans. We had to go all over trying to find husky jeans. Had a stroke at 19, 18 years old. 20 years old. And in football, Pop Warner, the coaches wanted you to gain some weight. So we really fed you the eggs and the bacon and the terrible. I'm so blessed, Nick, that maybe the hard way, by after having the stroke, you found a solution to our diet habits. And now at 86, I don't take any medications. My only downfall is exercise. I can't seem to want to get out there and jog. No, I don't have to jog. All I have to do is walk. But
you always show your hands. You have no arthritis.
Oh, yes. No arthritis. Yeah.
So what does this family gathering mean to you, and going and reflecting over your life and your kids and your grandkids now and great-grandkids? Oh, my gosh. You've got the whole group.
Yes, it's awesome, Nick. In fact, I look now and I think I should have had about four more.
Really?
The bigger the children, the family, the much better. Much better. Oh, yes. But, of course, I can't do it over again.
So who all is here, and tell us about it?
Well, I've got my oldest grandson, Jason, with his baby boy, which will carry out the Delgado name, Jimmy Delgado. In fact, it's James Isaiah Michael Delgado. Jimmy for short. Then we have my granddaughter Cherish and her husband Ramon and their baby Rue, and she's almost two. Very delicate, like a little princess. And she's already calling you, her grandpa, on the
Pop.
Pop, a.k.a. Pop, right? And then on the cell phone, you know, when she can get it away from Mama and Daddy when they leave it on the table or something. And then there's my grandson, Nicholas. He's a young man, and
I think he's turning 28 in November. Nicholas,
And then Wesley Oshman, my other grandson, and he's a young man, about 30 something, I think. Anyway, lose track of all their ages. And let's see, we've got cousin Debbie, your first cousin. So it's a marvelous gathering. Very wonderful.
So how important is family during these times of lockdown and isolation? What is the importance of family?
Well, the sad thing is that, you know what? I think right now I'm really appreciating getting together, taking family gatherings before this terrible mess for granted. You know, we take so much for granted. To get together and communicate and laugh about old times and even bring up issues that need to be discussed and settled, you know, all kinds of interaction that we miss during this time. So, yeah, I'm very blessed. I am and very blessed, Nick, that you put me on the right track to a healthier lifestyle by my diet and the supplements that you have created have given me no arthritis.
Yeah, no heart disease, no cancer. Nearly 40 years ago, I was blessed because I met Nathan Pritikin 43 years ago, and then I think you started a few years after, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I quit my Orange County government job, and I had been there 5 years, and my colleagues said, why would you go and quit this secure job? You're Mexican, you're a woman, you will never be fired. But I felt that what you had started needed to be pursued to let people know how important their health is. Again, we take things for granted. When you're young, you don't think of things going wrong as you get older because of a poor diet and the marketing that's promoted to encourage people to eat the four groups. And then fast food came into the picture. So that was really a downfall for the human body.
I think one of the important aspects during our 6 weekly classes, we'd meet once a week, was that we would have a lecture portion, but we always included what we called a whole plant-based, oil-free, sugar-free food demonstration. And you were a big part of taking that to these events for how many years? And what was that like?
Oh, that was very interesting. We had to prepare meals for the membership that enrolled into the program. And so we'd get hotel rooms. And we'd have to get there if you were there 4 hours early before the students arrived, it was a lot safer because sometimes the hotels were kind of messed up and you had the wrong room, you had the wrong supplies, tables, etc. And then we had to haul all the cooking equipment and all the pots and pans and all the everything, and then the food, and then prepare it in front of the membership, and then feed them, and then clean up everything. It was. I can't imagine how we accomplished that.
And it was recipes right from our cookbook, which has been updated and revised more recently, Simply Healthy Cookbook. And we also have How to Look Great and Feel Sexy. But, it had all the specifics of how do you prepare the measurement of the ingredients, what's important, why is it important. And you taught this during the classes for the new students coming in the first, second, third, fourth, fifth week. And it ended in a potluck on the 6th week, and they were so proud of their creations. What was the largest class size, and what do you remember people sharing with you, and even in the follow-up at the medical clinic, when they'd come for their sessions?
Well, people were amazed on how tasty the food was. I think that was number one. They were very surprised. Just as in this plant-based restaurant, the food is so tasty. You can't tell the difference it's enjoyable. So people, this place is crowded. And imagine, no animal products. But back to the classes, I remember after the people, what blessed me is once you're involved in a project, it becomes part of your lifestyle. So it was easy for me to continue that plant-based diet in my life, my everyday life. So, and the students, that's a little harder unless they got a mentor or some kind of a connection. And now with the internet and your YouTube and your the programs you present, they can keep in touch and therefore more be successful.
Yeah, a lot of the people, even the educators who presented the information, knew for all the reasons why it was important to not only go plant-based whole food, but let go of the sugar, but more importantly, get rid of the excess oils in the diet and move away from animal proteins and dairy product. And yet, years later, if they hadn't been part of the food demonstration programs, they never really learned the techniques and the habits and the skills to sustain and maintain that incredible ability. For you now, today being 86 years young, you started over 40 years ago. You're about 45, 46?
Probably, yes, I believe so. Yeah. I remember one time a couple students came up to me in way after they had gone through the program, and they continued to keep in touch with the office and the staff. And they would tell me that they'd go out to eat, there was a choice between a nice something juicy that they shouldn't be eating and the right thing to choose at the restaurant. And they said I was sitting on one shoulder, a little image on their shoulder, their conscience speaking, don't order that. You better order the right thing, It's not that, it's kind of funny.
Well, you were at the front desk at Delgado Medical, and you would collect their 24-hour food recall records, and you would quiz them about what they had eaten and why they hadn't done certain things. That was a moment of reckoning for each person to be accountable.
Yes. And, I'm a disciplinarian my whole life with my poor kids. But, yes, I was so strict on those diets. I mean, looking back, that was kind of poor people, I really...
They loved it.
Yeah.
They're better for it.
Yes, yeah.
If we had let them cheat on all the aspects...
No success. And then they would be discouraged and forget it. Then back to a deterioration, the slippery slope of going back in and slowly becoming disabled and arthritis.
Yeah, and if you think about it, the failure of the American Heart Association diet with making it so many concessions to match as close to the typical Western diet, or even the Diabetic Association diet, telling people give up sugar but not focusing in on the problem of oils and fats that desensitize the insulin, the Cancer Society, the American Cancer Society, and again, concessions, but they're all moving towards more vegetables, more fruit, more whole foods, and yet they didn't quite recognize there was that cutoff point where you're treating disease states, people already with chronic diseases, versus if they had started out maybe early in life and they followed a diet like that, it probably would have served them okay. But we were stricter only because we were using the food, the diet, as medicine to reverse diseases.
And that was before you created any supplements, so that we depended 100% on a success and the for the participant to see the change. It took takes about 90 days to form a habit, and then we besides that we test their blood, and the cholesterol levels would drop, Nick, and that was so encouraging. And then of course, as you go through the rest of the days of your diet approach, the cholesterol level and the blood test would increase, but that just shows the plaque being dissolved by clean blood in the arteries and discharging the cholesterol back into the bloodstream, excreting it through a bowel movement. And so, and I remember we used to tell them how much chicken can we have, or how much beef we can have, and I'd say one ounce, and it's about this big, and that, what? Oh, it was a shocker in the beginning.
It's important for people to recognize, Ramon, you're right in the camera, yeah, to recognize that the standards and the guidelines were proven within the medical literature and at the Pritikin Longevity Live-In Center. And we were going to modify the outpatient program. Pritikin himself had said, we'll include a little bit of meat each day. But we found out when they ate a little bit of meat each day, it wasn't a little bit. They would cheat on that amount. They'd eat more and their cholesterol wouldn't come down. Not only the cholesterol, because a lot of the public is confused still about cholesterol. They don't understand how the meat and dairy industry sponsored for the last 6 years, the most recent clinical studies trying to confuse the public about the importance of lowering cholesterol. But their triglycerides came down, their blood pressure came down, their energy went up, their glucose improved, every indicator, C-reactive protein, inflammatory markers, everything you could measure improved. I myself have been following this program for 43 years. You've been doing it for over 40 years. And we have students who showed back up. Phyllis Ginsburg, who started when she was 19 years old. Now, 40 years later, she's nearly 60. And my cousin Debbie here, who now is recently kind of rejoined or kind of checked in with considering a plant-based whole foods diet, her being my age, I'm not giving away ages, but, you know, we're up there, you know.